This is Your Sports Swindon, and I'm joined by Paddy Fitzpatrick for our weekly chat, Paddy's Say, where we discuss all things boxing with the Swindon trainer. Paddy, thanks for joining me.
No worries, bro.
So, of course, the thing that's hit the headlines this week in the world of boxing is Nick Blackwell and the fight against Chris Eubank Jr. Obviously, we wish him a full speedy recovery. But what we want to talk about today is the event itself and also the backlash that it's caused in certain people coming out and talking about the safety of boxing. So, first of all, did you watch the fight and what were your thoughts during it?
I did watch the fight and I thought it was an excellent fight. Obviously, nobody wants the outcome to happen, but yeah, it was an excellent fight.
And everyone's talked about the referee, and many have said that he did it to the book, played it well. Would you agree with that?
It's, you know, the second that the eye started to swell, he stopped it and got the doctor over, and he acted as quick as you could want him to act, yeah.
Definitely, and so yeah, the backlash that came from it was safety, and some actually saying lack of safety in boxing. What have your thoughts been since people have been coming out saying different things about boxing?
You know, I paid attention and then I didn't pay a lot of attention as well, because especially with social media these days, a lot of what you hear and read is just ridiculous, some of the comments. Is boxing dangerous? Yes, it is. Are we all aware of it, everyone that takes part? Yes, we are. And would we want to see anyone getting hurt? No. But is there other sports that people are just as susceptible to injury? A lot of them. I think it's just because boxing, people see it as the intent to hit the opponent. So then when somebody gets injured, they say, well, it was his intention to strike the man in the head. So therefore, it's an extremely tasteless or dangerous sport, and it shouldn't be allowed for those reasons. But you looked up yourself and told me some figures a while ago where there's other sports that you wouldn't even think that they were as dangerous an outcome, or they're actually far more dangerous.
Which, yeah, brings me on nicely to Formula One. So since 1952, obviously boxing going for hundreds of years, the same amount of deaths in boxing has happened in Formula One since 1952. And you don't see many people, if any, saying, let's stop F1 because of health and safety reasons. So what are your thoughts on that?
Just what I said, brother. I think it's just because people see it as the intent is to strike another man. So therefore they think, well, the intent is to cause as much damage to the other man, and it's not. It's to outscore the other man, outpoint the other man. Will the opponents get hurt? Yes, they will get hurt. Do other sports cause just as much damage, like you said? In what, 64 years? The more people have lost their lives in Formula One than 100 years in boxing. That's quite extraordinary statistics.
Certainly, it's something that I didn't actually think of, obviously, comparing the two sports, but something that's come out as well is people actually saying that, okay, boxing, not necessarily banned, but perhaps headshots banned. And obviously, you can still get your point scoring on the body, so would you be someone who's in favour of stopping a headshot?
No, not at all. And you'd have a sport that nobody wants to watch whatsoever. So how do we make Formula One safer then? Get them to drive maximum speed of 100 miles an hour? Maybe 80? You know, what do you do? You know, it's a risk. Everyone that's taking part in it are the ones that are putting themselves at risk. And the people that are putting themselves at risk are aware that the risk they're putting themselves in the line of. So, each to their own. The people who don't want to watch it, don't watch it.
So as a trainer, what do you say to your fighters, particularly after something like this has happened? Would you be changing the way that you talk to your fighters before a bout?
Would I be changing the way I talk to them? In what way?
So perhaps talking about the safety aspect of things, does it make you actually think, I need to be more careful of the way that I'm telling these people to fight? Or do you just still carry on as you would?
No, a fight's a fight. And if you're going to start talking to your fighters directly before a fight about the safety aspects, you're putting the wrong thoughts in their head. Because then hesitancy could cause more damage. And them not committing to stuff and not going about their work the way they should. No, you still conduct yourself. Always try to improve as a coach, but you're always trying to direct them in towards a win. That doesn't mean you're directing them towards causing damage to a man that's going to be, you know, detrimental to him. But you're not going to discuss the dangers of a fight just before a fight. Mm-hmm. We all know the dangers of a fight. We can talk about the dangers of this game in between fights, how that you need to be a consummate professional. Don't play with it. make sure you are getting enough sleep, make sure you are on a proper diet, and that you're doing things that you should be doing to keep yourself as healthy and able to take part in this game. But the last thing I would do is be discussing the dangers of a fight before a fight.
Okay, but perhaps what about during fight as a trainer? Have you ever been concerned for your boxer's safety during one?
Yes, I have, yeah. I've had Sammy Stewart, and I've asked two men to retire in 19 years of coaching. One was Sammy Stewart, flyweight I had from America, and the other one was Justin Dupa after he fought Miguel Cotto. And they were just really hard fights. And I'm always looking for a reason to stop a brutal fight. I'm looking for a reason. If I think that there's no longer an opportunity for my guy to win, or if I'm thinking that he's just taking too much and he's not even able to negate what's coming his way just to finish the rounds. So Eamon was involved in a brutal war Eamon appeared in his last fight. I was looking for an excuse, Madison Square Garden with Trina Johnson, looking for an excuse to stop him, but he didn't give me one until the 10th round when he took too many headshots, and I said, if you do that again, in the next round, I said, I'm stopping you. And he said, why, coach? Because you took too many shots to the head that round. Now, up until that round, he got dropped twice in the first round. Second round, nothing really happened. Third and fourth round was Torino's, but not in a brutal way, just there were his rounds. Fifth and sixth was Eamon's. Then the 7th, 8th and 9th, Eamon started backing up Torriano, and in every fight I'd watched Torriano up to that point, he doesn't back up, he only comes forward. So again, there was a reason to leave Eamon in there. There was still strength in his leg, there was still life in his eyes as he was looking at me. In the 10th round he took too many shots. But then when I told him, you got one more round to show me something, in the 11th and 12th he went out and was on him again and won those two rounds and two of the judges' scorecards. So, but I'm looking for an opportunity in a brutal fight. With Justin, when he fought Cotto, he had a long career. He had lost to Floyd at the time, he had lost to Diego Corrales at the time. But in a 9.5 week camp, he gave me every reason to believe that he could beat an up-and-coming guy called Miguel Cotto. But then in the first and second round, he was just waiting too much and not doing the things he should be doing. I think it was the third or fourth round, I said, you've got to turn it into a street fight. So he responded and turned it into a street fight. But then in the fifth round, he went back to start taking shots that he didn't need to again. And as I was coming up the apron, the referee and myself thought the same thing at the same time. I asked him to retire. He said he would, he promised him he would, and he didn't. But that's the mentality of a fight. Sammy did retire, and Justin didn't.
Okay, so yeah, talking there about basically responsibility as a coach to ensure that your box is safe. In that instance then, what would you have been saying if you were Nick Blackwell's coach last week?
I'm not going to go into that further, because that's just saying, would I have done anything better or worse than the man? Gary Lockett has got care for his fighters. He wasn't leaving him in there because he didn't care about him. He was leaving him in there, he knows Nick. He knows what type of mentality he is. And he obviously had a reason to believe that he's shown me in the gym the ability not only to be able to be in a hard fight, but to be able to pick things up later on. So I'm not going to get involved in that.
Okay, no worries. So yeah, that's one of the things as well that people are saying, that he was taking hits, but he was fighting back. There was certainly life still going, and he was fighting back, giving Chris as good as he got in many respects. So what are the things that you're looking for in your boxer during a fight? If they are on the back foot, what are you still hoping to see from him?
That his eyes are clear, that he's focused on me in the corner, and that his legs are good. The fact that he's taking shots, that alone can't be enough reason to stop these fights. We've never ever had the classics. We've never had Diego Corrales against Castillo. We've never had Thrill in Manila. We've never had Ben Eubanks. We've never had, these type of fights. You are in this game to be involved in those type of fights. You don't go into a fight hoping for it to be that brutal. But you like to look back in your career and think that I was involved in a fight that everyone is talking about. So you can't stop a fight just because a man is taking shots. I want to know, like I said, when he comes back, is he responsible? Is he clear? Can I see his eyes? Are he still focused on me? If he's changing in his character, if he's drifting away from me. If the legs don't look good, if he's not paying attention, then you start paying more attention. You're thinking, okay, things aren't looking good again. I'm going to give him a round or whatever. But you've got to know your fighter too. Some fighters just can take more than another man. And look at Arturo Gallo. Look at Carl Froch. He could take more than the average man. He wouldn't have had the career that he had if, because he was losing rounds, that you pulled him out. How many rounds did he lose against Jermaine Taylor? He stopped the man last round. And did he get damaged from Jermaine Taylor? No, he didn't. He's just able to take more than the average man. Rob McCracken would have known that about him. He's been with him his whole career. So each fighter is individual. Each trainer and fighter's relationship, I think, when it's a good one, is a special one, and they know each other very well. And you just hope that every coach pays attention and picks up on things when they should be picked up on. And then, if not, then the next man in the ring to protect him is the referee. But the referee had no reason to stop the Derby Ride. There wasn't anything that he was taking punishment and pulling away and not firing back. The second that swelling came up, he got involved. What more could he do?
Very true. So, obviously, we can all tell boxing is one of your biggest passions. And it's, in fact, would you go as far as saying boxing is your life?
Yeah, besides my family, boxing is completely my life. I'd be lost without it, for sure.
So, boxing is your life, let's say. So, how does it make you feel when you see people now coming out and saying boxing should be banned, it's just thuggery? What would you say to that?
Well, we've kind of been over that at the beginning. You know, people say that because when I say ignorance, I don't mean rudeness. I mean ignorance to the understanding of what boxing is. It's an art. It's an art. It's two men facing their biggest fears in front of each other and overcoming them. It's an art.
But how does that make you feel then, that people are actually effectively slating your sport?
It doesn't make me feel anything. It's their opinion. But social media, whatever used to happen in a pub of a Friday, Saturday night with 5 or 6 points in them, and everyone turns into the best manager in football and the best player and the best fighter, and now that happens every single night on social media. You've got people who have never ever went near a boxing gym, never ever put a glove on, never ever probably even watched many fights, are experts. They're experts. And you just don't pay no attention to somebody who knows nothing about what they're talking about. And if the people that do know what they're talking about are saying it should be banned because of the dangers, well then, in the space of 2 minutes on Google, you looked up and we even found out that in 64 years there's been more deaths driving a race car than there has been in a sport where the intention is to kill another man. So go and find out. There's no room these days for it to be unknowledgeable. It's right at your fingertips. And there's a lot of crap out on Google, a lot of stuff that doesn't mean anything. But there's also a world of information where you can look up and find out statistics and read up what other scientists or professors or other people have to say on any given subject. So when people make these remarks without first educating themselves, I pay no attention.
Super, thank you. Okay, so with all that's happened in the past week, what do you think is the future of boxing? Do you think anything is going to change, or is it going to stay how it is now?
I can't foresee the future. Could I be betting on horses? What much can change? They've made a lot of changes over the last few years, 20, 30 years now, to try and make boxing safer. Gone from 15 rounds to 12. 10 ounce gloves for welterweight and above, 8 for welterweight and below. There is health checks there. There's a lot more doctors right there ringside, oxygen right there ringside. They're making it as safe as they can. If you make it so safe that there is any risk factor at all taken away, well then what do you actually achieve to say that you're a world champion in any type of sport like that? where there is zero risk. There has to be high skill level in boxing and in racing driving, in rugby, in NFL. There's an element of risk as well as skill. If you take all that away, that's it. You know, no one's forced into this. People who take part in it because it's their choice. They want to do it. And we have to respect that.
Brilliant. Paddy, thank you for your time.
Cheers. Thank you.